bedrock of the imperial system. It was through the cities that government was able to tax the provincial countrysides, which generated much of the wealth of the empire. What this means is that the local upper classes actively collaborated with the Roman state in administering their own territories and raising taxes from them. In fact, one of the most interesting aspects of Roman political history is the dramatic shift in power between Italy and the provinces. Throughout the 2nd and 3rd centuries, it was the provincial upper classes who supplied most of the cadre that governed the provinces and commanded the armies. They came to form a new elite. Administrators and military commanders who became much more powerful than the senatorial class because they had the backing of the emperors. As this new group emerged, the emperor Gallienus, 253-68, consolidated their rise to power by excluding senators from military command. We are told that Gallienus forbade senators from serving in the army or having access to it, in order to prevent control of the empire from falling into their hands. To sum up, in the late 1st, 2nd and early 3rd centuries, the army and administration were increasingly drawn from the provinces, as citizenship spread to these regions and was no longer confined to Italy. But individuals of Italian origin continued to dominate the Senate at least till the 3rd century, when senators of provincial origin became a majority. These trends reflected the general decline of Italy within the empire, both political and economic, and the rise of new elites in the wealthier and more urbanized parts of the Mediterranean, such as the south of Spain, Africa, and the east. A city in the Roman sense was an urban center with its own magistrates, city council, and a territory, containing villages which were under its jurisdiction. Thus, one city could not be in the territory of another city, but villages almost always were. Villages could be upgraded to the status of cities, and vice versa, usually as a mark of imperial favor, or the opposite. One crucial advantage of living in a city was simply that it might be better provided for during food shortages and even famines than the countryside. Public baths were a striking feature of Roman urban life. When one Iranian ruler tried to introduce them into Iran, he encountered the wrath of the clergy there. Water was a sacred element, and to use it for public bathing may have seemed a desecration to them, and urban populations also enjoyed a much higher level of entertainment. For example, one calendar tells us that spectaculae shows filled no less than 176 days of the year. The 3rd century crisis. If the 1st and 2nd centuries were by and large a period of peace, prosperity and economic expansion, the 3rd century brought the first major signs of internal strain. From the 230s, the empire found itself fighting on several fronts simultaneously. In Iran, a new and more aggressive dynasty emerged in 225. They called themselves the Sasanians, and within just 15 years were expanding rapidly in the direction of the Euphrates. In a famous rock inscription cut in three languages, Shapur I, the Iranian ruler, claimed he had annihilated a Roman army of 60,000 and even captured the eastern capital of Antioch. Meanwhile, a whole series of Germanic tribes, or rather tribal confederacies, most notably the Alemanni, the Franks, and the Goths, began to move against the Rhine and Danube frontiers, and the whole period from 233 to 280 saw repeated invasions of a whole line of provinces that stretched from the Black Sea to the Alps and southern Germany. The Romans were forced to abandon much of the territory beyond the Danube, while the emperors of this period were constantly in the field against what the Romans called barbarians. The rapid succession of emperors in the 3rd century, 25 emperors in 47 years, is an obvious symptom of the strains faced by the empire in this period. Gender, literacy, culture. One of the more modern features of Roman society was the widespread prevalence of the nuclear family. Adult sons did not live with their families, and it was exceptional for adult brothers to share a common household. On the other hand, slaves were included in the family as the Romans understood this. By the late Republic, the 1st century BCE, the typical form of marriage was one where the wife did not transfer to her husband's authority but retained full rights in the property of her natal family. While the woman's dowry went to the husband for the duration of the marriage, the woman remained a primary heir of her father and became an independent property owner on her father's death. Thus, Roman women enjoyed considerable legal rights in owning and managing property. In other words, in law, the married couple was not one financial entity but two, and the wife enjoyed complete legal independence. Divorce was relatively easy and needed no more than a notice of intent to dissolve the marriage by either husband or wife. On the other hand, whereas males married in their late 20s or early 30s, women were married off in the late teens or early 20s, so there was an age gap between husband and wife, and this would have encouraged a certain inequality. Marriages were generally arranged, and there is no doubt that women were often subject to domination by their husbands. Augustine, the great Catholic bishop who spent most of his life in North Africa, tells us that his mother was regularly beaten by his father and that most other wives in the small town where he grew up had similar bruises to show. Finally, fathers had substantial legal control over their children, sometimes to a shocking degree, for example, a legal power of life and death in exposing unwanted children by leaving them out in the cold to die. What about literacy? It is certain that rates of casual literacy varied greatly between different parts of the empire. For example, in Pompeii, which was buried in a volcanic eruption in 79 CE, there is strong evidence of widespread casual literacy. Walls on the main streets of Pompeii often carried advertisements, and graffiti were found all over the city. By contrast, in Egypt, where hundreds of papyri survive, most formal documents such as contracts were usually written by professional scribes, and they often tell us that X or Y is unable to read and write. But even here, literacy was certainly more widespread among certain categories such as soldiers, army officers, and estate managers. The cultural diversity of the empire was reflected in many ways and at many levels, in the vast diversity of religious cults and local deities, the plurality of languages that were spoken, the styles of dress and costume, the food people ate, their forms of social organization, tribal, non-tribal, even their patterns of settlement. Aramaic was the dominant language group of the Near East, at least west of the Euphrates. Coptic was spoken in Egypt, Punic and Berber in North Africa, Celtic in Spain and the Northwest. But many of these linguistic cultures were purely oral, at least until a script was invented for them. Armenian, for example, only began to be written as late as the 5th century, whereas there was already a Coptic translation of the Bible by the middle of the 3rd century. Elsewhere, the spread of Latin displaced the written form of languages that were otherwise widespread. This happened notably with Celtic, which ceased to be written after the 1st century. Economic expansion. The empire had a substantial economic infrastructure of harbors, mines, quarries, brickyards, olive oil factories, etc. Wheat, wine and olive oil were traded and consumed in huge quantities, and they came mainly from Spain, the Gallic provinces, North Africa, Egypt and, to a lesser extent, Italy, where conditions were best for these crops. Liquids like wine and olive oil were transported in containers called amphorae. The fragments and sherds of a very large number of these survive. Monte Testaccio in Rome is said to contain the remnants of over 50 million vessels, and it has been possible for archaeologists to reconstruct the precise shapes of these containers, tell us what they carried, and say exactly where they were made by examining the clay content and matching the finds with clay pits throughout the Mediterranean. In this way, we can now say with some confidence that Spanish olive oil, to take just one example, was a vast commercial enterprise that reached its peak in the years 140 to 160. The Spanish olive oil of this period was mainly carried in a container called Dressel 20, after the archaeologist who first established its form. If finds of Dressel 20 are widely scattered across sites in the Mediterranean, this suggests that Spanish olive oil circulated very widely indeed. By using such evidence, the remains of amphorae of different kinds and their distribution maps, archaeologists are able to show that Spanish producers succeeded in capturing markets for olive oil from their Italian counterparts. This would only have happened if Spanish producers supplied better quality oil at lower prices. In other words, the big landowners from different regions competed with each other for control of the main markets for the goods they produced. The success of the Spanish olive growers was then repeated by North African producers. Olive estates in this part of the empire dominated production through most of the 3rd and 4th centuries. The success of the Spanish olive growers was then repeated by North African producers. Olive estates in this part of the empire dominated production through most of the 3rd and 4th centuries. Later, after 425, North African dominance was broken by the East. In the later 5th and 6th centuries, the Aegean, Southern Asia Minor, Turkey, Syria and Palestine became major exporters of wine and olive oil, and containers from Africa show a dramatically reduced presence on Mediterranean markets. Behind these broad movements, the prosperity of individual regions rose and fell depending on how effectively they could organize the production and transport of particular goods, and on the quality of those goods. The empire included many regions that had a reputation for exceptional fertility. Campania in Italy, Sicily, the Fayum in Egypt, Galilee, Byzantium, Tunisia, southern Gaul, called Gallia Narbonensis, and Baetica, southern Spain, were all among the most densely settled or wealthiest parts of the empire, according to writers like Strabo and Pliny. The best kinds of wine came from Campania. Sicily and Byzantium exported large quantities of wheat to Rome. Galilee was densely cultivated. Every inch of the soil has been cultivated by the inhabitants, wrote the historian Josephus, and Spanish olive oil came mainly from numerous estates, fundi, along the banks of the river Guadalquivir in the south of Spain. On the other hand, large expanses of Roman territory were in a much less advanced state. For example, transhumance was widespread in the countryside of Numidia, modern Algeria. These pastoral and semi-nomadic communities were often on the move, carrying their oven-shaped huts, called mappalia, with them. As Roman estates expanded in North Africa, the pastures of those communities were drastically reduced and their movements more tightly regulated. Even in Spain, the north was much less developed, and inhabited largely by a Celtic-speaking peasantry that lived in hilltop villages called castella. When we think of the Roman Empire, we should never forget these differences. We should also be careful not to imagine that because this was the ancient world, their forms of cultural and economic life were necessarily backward or primitive. On the contrary, diversified applications of water power around the Mediterranean, as well as advances in water-powered milling technology, the use of hydraulic mining techniques in the Spanish gold and silver mines, and the gigantic industrial scale on which those mines were worked in the 1st and 2nd centuries, with levels of output that would not be reached again till the 19th century, some 1,700 years later, the existence of well-organized commercial and banking networks, and the widespread use of money are all indications of how much we tend to underestimate the sophistication of the Roman economy. This raises the issue of labor and of the use of slavery. Controlling workers' slavery was an institution deeply rooted in the ancient world, both in the Mediterranean and in the Near East, and not even Christianity, when it emerged and triumphed as the state religion in the 4th century, seriously challenged this institution. It does not follow that the bulk of the labor in the Roman economy was performed by slaves. That may have been true of large parts of Italy in the Republican period. Under Augustus, there were still 3 million slaves in a total Italian population of 7.5 million, but it was no longer true of the empire as a whole. Slaves were an investment, and at least one Roman agricultural writer advised landowners against using them in contexts where too many might be required, for example, for harvests, or where their health could be damaged, for example, by malaria. These considerations were not based on any sympathy for the slaves, but on hard economic calculation. On the other hand, if the Roman upper classes were often brutal towards their slaves, ordinary people did sometimes show much more compassion. See what one historian says about a famous incident that occurred in the reign of Nero. As warfare became less widespread with the establishment of peace in the 1st century, the supply of slaves tended to decline, and the users of slave labor thus had to turn either to slave breeding or to cheaper substitutes such as wage labor, which was more easily dispensable. In fact, free labor was extensively used on public works at Rome precisely because an extensive use of slave labor would have been too expensive. Unlike hired workers, slaves had to be fed and maintained throughout the year, which increased the cost of holding this kind of labor. This is probably why slaves are not widely found in the agriculture of the later period, at least not in the eastern provinces. On the other hand, they and freedmen, that is, slaves who had been set free by their masters, were extensively used as business managers, where, obviously, they were not required in large numbers. Masters often gave their slaves or freedmen capital to run businesses on their behalf or even businesses of their own. The Roman agricultural writers paid a great deal of attention to the management of labor. Columella, a first century writer who came from the south of Spain, recommended that landowners should keep a reserve stock of implements and tools, twice as many as they needed, so that production could be continuous, for the loss in slave labor time exceeds the cost of such items. There was a general presumption among employers that without supervision no work would ever get done, so supervision was paramount, for both free workers and slaves. To make supervision easier, workers were sometimes grouped into gangs or smaller teams. Columella recommended squads of 10, claiming it was easier to tell who was putting in effort and who was not in work groups of this size. This shows a detailed consideration of the management of labor. Pliny the Elder, the author of a very famous natural history, condemned the use of slave gangs as the worst method of organizing production, mainly because slaves who worked in gangs were usually chained together by their feet. All this looks draconian, but we should remember that most factories in the world today enforce similar principles of labor control. Indeed, some industrial establishments in the empire enforced even tighter controls. The elder Pliny described conditions in the frankincense factories, officinae, of Alexandria, where, he tells us, no amount of supervision seemed to suffice. A seal is put upon the workmen's aprons, they have to wear a mask or a net with a clothes mesh on their heads, and before they are allowed to leave the premises, they have to take off all their clothes. Agricultural labor must have been fatiguing and disliked, for a famous edict of the early 3rd century refers to Egyptian peasants deserting their villages in order not to engage in agricultural work. The same was probably true of most factories and workshops. A law of 398 referred to workers being branded so they could be recognized if and when they run away and try to hide. Many private employers cast their agreements with workers in the form of debt contracts to be able to claim that their employees were in debt to them and thus ensure tighter control over them. An early, second century writer tells us, thousands surrender themselves to work in servitude, although they are free. In other words, a lot of the poorer families went into debt bondage in order to survive. From one of the recently discovered letters of Augustine, we learn that parents sometimes sold their children into servitude for periods of 25 years. Augustine asked a lawyer friend of his whether these children could be liberated once the father died. Rural indebtedness was even more widespread. To take just one example, in the great Jewish revolt of 66 CE, the revolutionaries destroyed the moneylenders' bonds to win popular support. Again, we should be careful not to conclude that the bulk of labor was coerced in these ways. The late 5th century emperor Anastasius built the eastern frontier city of Dara in less than 3 weeks by attracting labor from all over the east by offering high wages. From the papyri we can even form some estimate of how widespread wage labor had become in parts of the Mediterranean by the 6th century, especially in the east. Social hierarchies let us stand back from the details now and try and get a sense of the social structures of the empire. Tacitus described the leading social groups of the early empire as follows: senators, patres, lit, fathers, leading members of the equestrian class, the respectable section of the people, those attached to the great houses, the unkempt lower class, plebs sordida, who, he tells us, were addicted to the circus and theatrical displays, and finally the slaves. In the early 3rd century, when the Senate numbered roughly 1,000, approximately half of all senators still came from Italian families. By late empire, which starts with the reign of Constantine I in the early part of the 4th century, the first two groups mentioned by Tacitus, the senators and the equites, had merged into a unified and expanded aristocracy, and at least half of all families were of African or Eastern origin. This late Roman aristocracy was enormously wealthy but in many ways less powerful than the purely military elites who came almost entirely from non-aristocratic backgrounds. The middle class now consisted of the considerable mass of persons connected with imperial service in the bureaucracy and army, but also the more prosperous merchants and farmers, of whom there were many in the eastern provinces. Tacitus described this respectable middle class as clients of the great senatorial houses. Now it was chiefly government service and dependence on the state that sustained many of these families. Below them were the vast mass of the lower classes known collectively as humiliores, lit. Lora. They comprised a rural labor force of which many were permanently employed on the large estates, workers in industrial and mining establishments, migrant workers who supplied much of the labor for the grain and olive harvests and for the building industry, self-employed artisans who, it was said, were better fed than wage laborers, a large mass of casual laborers, especially in the big cities, and of course the many thousands of slaves that were still found all over the Western Empire in particular. One writer of the early 5th century, the historian Olympiodorus, who was also an ambassador, tells us that the aristocracy based in the city of Rome drew annual incomes of up to 4,000 pounds of gold from their estates, not counting the produce they consumed directly. The monetary system of the late empire broke with the silver-based currencies of the first 3 centuries because the Spanish silver mines were exhausted and government ran out of sufficient stocks of the metal to support a stable coinage in silver. Constantine founded the new monetary system on gold, and there were vast amounts of this in circulation throughout late antiquity. The late Roman bureaucracy, both the higher and middle echelons, was a comparatively affluent group because it drew the bulk of its salary in gold and invested much of this in buying up assets like land. There was, of course, also a great deal of corruption, especially in the judicial system and in the administration of military supplies. The extortion of the higher bureaucracy and the greed of the provincial governors were proverbial, but government intervened repeatedly to curb these forms of corruption. We only know about them in the first place because of the laws that tried to put an end to them, and because historians and other members of the intelligentsia denounced such practices. This element of criticism is a remarkable feature of the classical world. The Roman state was an authoritarian regime. In other words, dissent was rarely tolerated and government usually responded to protest with violence, especially in the cities of the East where people were often fearless in making fun of emperors. Yet a strong tradition of Roman law had emerged by the 4th century, and this acted as a brake on even the most fearsome emperors. Emperors were not free to do whatever they liked, and the law was actively used to protect civil rights. That is why in the later 4th century it was possible for powerful bishops like Ambrose to confront equally powerful emperors when they were excessively harsh or repressive in their handling of the civilian population. Late antiquity. We shall conclude this chapter by looking at the cultural transformation of the Roman world in its final centuries. Late antiquity is the term now used to describe the final, fascinating period in the evolution and breakup of the Roman Empire and refers broadly to the 4th to 7th centuries. The 4th century itself was one of considerable ferment, both cultural and economic. At the cultural level, the period saw momentous developments in religious life, with the Emperor Constantine deciding to make Christianity the official religion, and with the rise of Islam in the 7th century. But there were equally important changes in the structure of the state that began with the Emperor Diocletian, 284-305, and it may be best to start with these. Overexpansion had led Diocletian to cut back by abandoning territories with little strategic or economic value. Diocletian also fortified the frontiers, reorganized provincial boundaries, and separated civilian from military functions, granting greater autonomy to the military commanders, duces, who now became a more powerful group. Constantine consolidated some of these changes and added others of his own. His chief innovations were in the monetary sphere, where he introduced a new denomination, the solidus, a coin of 4.5 gm of pure gold that would in fact outlast the Roman Empire itself. Solidi were minted on a very large scale and their circulation ran into millions. The other area of innovation was the creation of a second capital at Constantinople, at the site of modern Istanbul in Turkey, and previously called Byzantium, surrounded on 3 sides by the sea. As the new capital required a new senate, the 4th century was a period of rapid expansion of the governing classes. Monetary stability and an expanding population stimulated economic growth, and the archaeological record shows considerable investment in rural establishments, including industrial installations like oil presses and glass factories, in newer technologies such as screw presses and multiple watermills, and in a revival of the long-distance trade with the East. All of this carried over into strong urban prosperity that was marked by new forms of architecture and an exaggerated sense of luxury. The ruling elites were wealthier and more powerful than ever before. In Egypt, hundreds of papyri survive from these later centuries, and they show us a relatively affluent society where money was in extensive use and rural estates generated vast incomes in gold. For example, Egypt contributed taxes of over 2.5 million solidi a year, roughly 35,000 pounds of gold, in the reign of Justinian in the 6th century. Indeed, large parts of the Near Eastern countryside were more developed and densely settled in the 5th and 6th centuries than they would be even in the 20th century. This is the social background against which we should set the cultural developments of this period. The traditional religious culture of the classical world, both Greek and Roman, had been polytheist. That is, it involved a multiplicity of cults that included both Roman, Italian gods like Jupiter, Juno, Minerva, and Mars, as well as numerous Greek and Eastern deities worshipped in thousands of temples, shrines, and sanctuaries throughout the empire. Polytheists had no common name or label to describe themselves. The other great religious tradition in the empire was Judaism. But Judaism was not a monolith either, and there was a great deal of diversity within the Jewish communities of late antiquity. Thus, the Christianization of the empire in the 4th and 5th centuries was a gradual and complex process. Polytheism did not disappear overnight, especially in the western provinces, where the Christian bishops waged a running battle against beliefs and practices they condemned more than the Christian laity did. The boundaries between religious communities were much more fluid in the 4th century than they would become thanks to the repeated efforts of religious leaders, the powerful bishops who now led the church, to rein in their followers and enforce a more rigid set of beliefs and practices. The general prosperity was especially marked in the East, where population was still expanding till the 6th century, despite the impact of the plague which affected the Mediterranean in the 540s. In the West, by contrast, the empire fragmented politically as Germanic groups from the north, Goths, Vandals, Lombards, etc., took over all the major provinces and established kingdoms that are best described as post-Roman. The most important of these were that of the Visigoths in Spain, destroyed by the Arabs between 711 and 720, that of the Franks in Gaul, c. 511 to 687, and that of the Lombards in Italy, 568 to 774. These kingdoms foreshadowed the beginnings of a different kind of world that is usually called medieval. In the East, where the empire remained united, the reign of Justinian is the high-water mark of prosperity and imperial ambition. Justinian recaptured Africa from the Vandals in 533, but his recovery of Italy from the Ostrogoths left that country devastated and paved the way for the Lombard invasion. By the early 7th century, the war between Rome and Iran had flared up again, and the Sasanians, who had ruled Iran since the 3rd century, launched a wholesale invasion of all the major eastern provinces, including Egypt. When Byzantium, as the Roman Empire was now increasingly known, recovered these provinces in the 620s, it was just a few years away, literally, from the final major blow, which came, this time, from the southeast. The expansion of Islam from its beginnings in Arabia has been called the greatest political revolution ever to occur in the history of the ancient world. By 642, barely 10 years after Prophet Muhammad's death, large parts of both the Eastern Roman and Sasanian empires had fallen to the Arabs in a series of stunning confrontations. However, we should bear in mind that those conquests, which eventually, a century later, extended as far afield as Spain, Sindh, and Central Asia, began in fact with the subjection of the Arab tribes by the emerging Islamic state, first within Arabia and then in the Syrian desert and on the fringes of Iraq. As we will see in Theme 4, the unification of the Arabian Peninsula and its numerous tribes was the key factor behind the territorial expansion of Islam. The Republic was the name for a regime in which the reality of power lay with the Senate, a body dominated by a small group of wealthy families who formed the nobility. In practice, the Republic represented the government of the nobility, exercised through the body called the Senate. the Republic lasted from 509 BC to 27 BC, when it was overthrown by Octavian, the adopted son and heir of Julius Caesar, who later changed his name to Augustus. Membership of the Senate was for life, and wealth and office holding counted for more than birth. A conscripted army is one which is forcibly recruited. Military service is compulsory for certain groups or categories of the population. Civil war refers to armed struggles for power within the same country, in contrast to conflicts between different countries. The Emperor Trajan's dream, a conquest of India. Then, after a winter, 115-16, in Antioch marked by a great earthquake, in 116 Trajan marched down the Euphrates to Ctesiphon, the Parthian capital, and then to the head of the Persian Gulf. There, the historian, Cassius Dio describes him looking longingly at a merchant ship setting off for India, and wishing that he were as young as Alexander. Fergus Milla, the Roman Near East, the Near East from the perspective of someone who lived in the Roman Mediterranean, this referred to all the territory east of the Mediterranean, chiefly the Roman provinces of Syria, Palestine and Mesopotamia, and in a looser sense the surrounding territories, for example Arabia. These were local kingdoms that were clients of Rome. Their rulers could be relied on to use their forces in support of Rome, and in return Rome allowed them to exist. Pont du Gard, near Reims, France, 1st century BCE. Roman engineers built massive aqueducts over three continents to carry water. The Dr. Galen on how Roman cities treated the countryside. The famine prevalent for many successive years in many provinces has clearly displayed for men of any understanding the effect of malnutrition in generating illness. The city dwellers, as it was their custom to collect and store enough grain for the whole of the next year immediately after the harvest, carried off all the wheat, barley, beans and lentils, and left to the peasants various kinds of pulse. After taking quite a large proportion of these to the city, after consuming what was left in the course of the winter, the country people had to resort to unhealthy foods in the spring. They ate twigs and shoots of trees and bushes and bulbs and roots of inedible plants. Galen, On Good and Bad Diet. St. Augustine, 354-430, was bishop of the North African city of Hippo from 396 and a towering figure in the intellectual history of the church. Bishops were the most important religious figures in a Christian community, and often very powerful. One of the funniest of these graffiti found on the walls of Pompeii says, "Wall, I admire you for not collapsing in ruins when you have to support so much boring writing on you." Transhumance is the herdsman's regular annual movement between the higher mountain regions and lowlying ground in search of pasture for sheep and other flocks. On the treatment of slaves, soon afterwards the city prefect, Lucius Petinius Secundus, was murdered by one of his slaves. After the murder, ancient custom required that every slave residing under the same roof must be executed, but a crowd gathered, eager to save so many innocent lives, and rioting began. The Senate House was besieged. Inside, there was feeling against excessive severity, but the majority opposed any change. The senators, favoring execution, prevailed. However, great crowds ready with stones and torches prevented the order from being carried out. Nero rebuked the population by edict, and lined with troops the whole route along which those condemned were taken for execution. Tacitus, 55-117, historian of the early empire, draconian, harsh, so called because of an early 6th century BCE Greek lawmaker called Draco, who prescribed death as the penalty for most crimes. Frankincense, the European name for an aromatic resin used in incense and perfumes. It is tapped from boswellia trees by slashing the bark and allowing the exuded resins to harden. The best quality frankincense came from the Arabian Peninsula. The equites, knights or horsemen, were traditionally the second most powerful and wealthy group. Originally, they were families whose property qualified them to serve in the cavalry, hence the name. Like senators, most knights were landowners, but unlike senators, many of them were shipowners, traders and bankers, that is, involved in business activities. Incomes of the Roman aristocracy, early 5th century, each of the great houses of Rome contained within itself everything which a medium-sized city could hold, a hippodrome, fora, temples, fountains and different kinds of baths. Many of the Roman households received an income of 4,000 pounds of gold per year from their properties, not including grain, wine and other produce which, if sold, would have amounted to own a third of the income in gold. The income of the households at Rome of the second class was 1,000 or 1,500 pounds of gold. Olympiodorus of Thebes, 27 BCE. Principate, founded by Octavian, now calls himself Augustus, c. 24-79. Life of the elder Pliny, dies in the volcanic eruption of Vesuvius, which also buries the Roman town of Pompeii, 66-70. The great Jewish revolt and capture of Jerusalem by Roman forces, c. 115. Greatest extent of the Roman Empire, following Trajan's conquests in the east, 212. All free inhabitants of the empire transformed into Roman citizens. 224. New dynasty founded in Iran, called Sasanians after ancestor Sasan. 250s. Persians invade Roman territories west of the Euphrates. 258. Cyprian bishop of Carthage executed. 260s. Gallienus reorganizes the army. 273. Caravan city of Palmyra destroyed by Romans. 297. Diocletian reorganizes empire into c. 100 provinces. c. 310. Constantine issues new gold coinage, the solidus. 312. Constantine converts to Christianity. 324. Constantine, now sole ruler of empire, founds city of Constantinople. 354-430. Life of Augustine, bishop of Hippo. 378. Goths inflict crushing defeat on Roman armies at Adrianople. 391. Destruction of the Serapeum, Temple of Serapis, at Alexandria. 410. Sack of Rome by the Visigoths. 428. Vandals capture Africa. 434-53. Empire of Attila the Hun. 493. Ostrogoths establish kingdom in Italy. 533-50. Recovery of Africa and Italy by Justinian. 541-70. Outbreaks of bubonic plague. 568. Lombards invade Italy. c. 570. Birth of Muhammad. 614-19. Persian ruler Khusro II invades and occupies eastern Roman territories. 622. Muhammad and companions leave Mecca for Medina. 633-42. First and crucial phase of the Arab conquests. Muslim armies take Syria, Palestine, Egypt, Iraq and parts of Iran. 661-2. Umayyad dynasty in Syria. 698. Arabs capture Carthage. 711. Arab invasion of Spain. Theme 4. The Central Islamic Lands. As we enter the 21st century, there are over 1 billion Muslims living in all parts of the world. They are citizens of different nations, speak different languages, and dress differently. The processes by which they became Muslims were varied, and so were the circumstances in which they went their separate ways. Yet, the Islamic community has its roots in a more unified past which unfolded roughly 1,400 years ago in the Arabian Peninsula. In this chapter, we are going to read about the rise of Islam and its expansion over a vast territory extending from Egypt to Afghanistan, the core area of Islamic civilization from 600 to 1200. In these centuries, Islamic society exhibited multiple political and cultural patterns. The term Islamic is used here not only in its purely religious sense but also for the overall society and culture historically associated with Islam. In this society, not everything that was happening originated directly from religion, but it took place in a society where Muslims and their faith were recognized as socially dominant. On Muslims always formed an integral, if subordinate, part of this society, as did Jews in Christendom. Our understanding of the history of the Central Islamic lands between 600 and 1200 is based on chronicles or tawarikh, which narrate events in order of time, and semi-historical works, such as biographies, sirah, records of the sayings and doings of the Prophet, hadith, and commentaries on the Quran, tafsir. The material from which these works were produced was a large collection of eyewitness reports, akbar, transmitted over a period of time either orally or on paper. The authenticity of each report, kabar, was tested by a critical method which traced the chain of transmission, isnad, and established the reliability of the narrator. Although the method was not foolproof, medieval Muslim writers were more careful in selecting their information and understanding the motives of their informants than were their contemporaries in other parts of the world. On controversial issues, they reproduced different versions of the same event, as they found in their sources, leaving the task of judgment to their readers. Their description of events closer to their own times is more systematic and analytical and less of a collection of akbar. Most of the chronicles and semi-historical works are in Arabic, the best being the Tariq of Tabari, Death 923, which has been translated into English in 38 volumes. Persian chronicles are few, but they are quite detailed in their treatment of Iran and Central Asia. Christian chronicles, written in Syriac, a dialect of Aramaic, are fewer, but they throw interesting light on the history of early Islam. Besides chronicles, we have legal texts, geographies, travelogues and literary works, such as stories and poems. Documentary evidence, fragmentary pieces of writing, such as official orders or private correspondence, is the most valuable for writing histories because it does not consciously refer to events and persons. It comes almost entirely from Greek and Arabic papyri, good for administrative history, and the Geniza records. Some evidence has emerged from archaeological excavations done at desert palaces, numismatic study of coins, and epigraphic study of inscriptions, sources which is of great value for economic history, art history, and for establishing names and dates. Proper histories of Islam began to be written in the 19th century by university professors in Germany and the Netherlands. Colonial interests in the Middle East and North Africa encouraged French and British researchers to study Islam as well. Christian priests too paid close attention to the history of Islam and produced some good work, although their interest was mainly to compare Islam with Christianity. These scholars, called Orientalists, are known for their knowledge of Arabic and Persian and critical analysis of original texts. Ignaz Golgier was a Hungarian Jew who studied at the Islamic College, Al-Azhar, in Cairo and produced path-breaking studies in German of Islamic law and theology. 20th century historians. Islam have largely followed the interests and methods of Orientalists. They have widened the scope of Islamic history by including new topics, and by using allied disciplines, such as economics, anthropology and statistics, have refined many aspects of Orientalist studies. The historiography of Islam is a good example of how religion can be studied with modern historical methods by those who may not share the customs and beliefs of the people they are studying. The rise of Islam in Arabia, faith, community and politics during 612 to 632, the Prophet Muhammad preached the worship of a single God, Allah, and the membership of a single community of believers, Ummah. This was the origin of Islam. Muhammad was an Arab by language and culture and a merchant by profession. 6th century Arab culture was largely confined to the Arabian Peninsula and areas of southern Syria and Mesopotamia. The Arabs were divided into tribes, Kabila, each led by a chief who was chosen partly on the basis of his family connections but more for his personal courage, wisdom and generosity, Murawa. Each tribe had its own god or goddess, who was worshipped as an idol, Sanam, in a shrine, Masjid. Many Arab tribes were nomadic, Bedouins, moving from dry to green areas, oases, of the desert in search of food, mainly dates, and fodder for their camels. Some settled in cities and practiced trade or agriculture. Muhammad's own tribe, Quraysh, lived in Mecca and controlled the main shrine there, a Kuba-like structure called Kaaba, in which idols were placed. Even tribes outside Mecca considered the Kaaba holy and installed their own idols at this shrine, making annual pilgrimages, Hajj, to the shrine. Mecca was located on the crossroads of a trade route between Yemen and Syria, which further enhanced the city's importance. The Meccan shrine was a sanctuary, Haram, where violence was forbidden and protection given to all visitors. Pilgrimage and commerce gave the nomadic and settled tribes opportunities to communicate with one another and share their beliefs and customs. Although the polytheistic Arabs were vaguely familiar with the notion of a supreme god, Allah, possibly under the influence of the Jewish and Christian tribes living in their midst, their attachment to idols and shrines was more immediate and stronger. Around 612, Muhammad declared himself to be the messenger, Rasul, of God who had been commanded to preach that Allah alone should be worshipped. The worship involved simple rituals, such as daily prayers, salat, and moral principles, such as distributing alms and abstaining from theft. Muhammad was to found a community of believers, Ummah, bound by a common set of religious beliefs. The community would bear witness, Shahada, to the existence of the religion before God as well as before members of other religious communities. Muhammad's message particularly appealed to those Meccans who felt deprived of the gains from trade and religion and were looking for a new community identity. Those who accepted the doctrine were called Muslims. They were promised salvation on the Day of Judgment, Qiyama, and a share of the resources of the community while on earth. The Muslims soon faced considerable opposition from affluent Meccans who took offense to the rejection of their deities and found the new religion a threat to the status and prosperity of Mecca. In 622, Muhammad was forced to migrate with his followers to Medina. Muhammad's journey from Mecca, Hijra, was a turning point in the history of Islam, with the year of his arrival in Medina marking the beginning of the Muslim calendar. The survival of a religion rests on the survival of the community of believers. The community has to be consolidated internally and protected from external dangers. Consolidation and protection require political institutions such as states and governments, which are either inherited from the past, borrowed from outside, or created from scratch. In Medina, Muhammad created a political order from all three sources which gave his followers the protection they needed as well as resolved the city's ongoing civil strife. The Ummah was converted into a wider community to include Polytheists and the Jews of Medina under the political leadership of Muhammad. Muhammad consolidated the faith for his followers by adding and refining rituals, such as fasting, and ethical principles. The community survived on agriculture and trade, as well as an alms tax, zakat. In addition, the Muslims organized expeditionary raids, ghazw, on Meccan caravans and nearby oases. These raids provoked reactions from the Meccans and caused a breach with the Jews of Medina. After a series of battles, Mecca was conquered and Muhammad's reputation as a religious preacher and political leader spread far and wide. Muhammad now insisted on conversion as the sole criterion for membership of the community. In the harsh conditions of the desert, the Arabs attached great value to strength and solidarity. Impressed by Muhammad's achievements, many tribes, mostly Bedouins, joined the community by converting to Islam. Muhammad's alliances began to spread until they embraced the whole of Arabia. Medina became the administrative capital of the emerging Islamic state with Mecca as its religious center. The Kaaba was cleansed of idols as Muslims were required to face the shrine when offering prayers. In a short space of time, Muhammad was able to unite a large part of Arabia under a new faith, community and state. The early Islamic polity, however, remained a federation of Arab tribes and clans for a long time. The Caliphate, expansion, civil wars and sect formation after Muhammad's death in 632, no one could legitimately claim to be the next prophet of Islam. As a result, his political authority was transferred to the Ummah with no established principle of succession. This created opportunities for innovations but also caused deep divisions among the Muslims. The biggest innovation was the creation of the institution of caliphate, in which the leader of the community, Amir al-Mu'minin, became the deputy, khalifa, of the prophet. The first four caliphs, 632-61, justified their powers on the basis of their close association with the prophet and continued his work under the general guidelines he had provided. The twin objectives of the caliphate were to retain control over the tribes constituting the Ummah and to raise resources for the state. Following Muhammad's death, many tribes broke away from the Islamic state. Some even raised their own prophets to establish communities modeled on the Ummah. The first caliph, Abu Bakr, suppressed the revolts by a series of campaigns. The second caliph, Umar, shaped the Umma's policy of expansion of power. The caliph knew that the Ummah could not be maintained out of the modest income derived from trade and taxes. Realizing that rich booty, Ghanima, could be obtained from expeditionary raids, the caliph and his military commanders mustered their tribal strength to conquer lands belonging to the Byzantine Empire in the west and the Sasanian Empire in the east. At the height of their power, the Byzantine and Sasanian empires ruled vast territories and commanded huge resources to pursue their political and commercial interests in Arabia. The Byzantine Empire promoted Christianity and the Sasanian Empire patronized Zoroastrianism, the ancient religion of Iran. On the eve of the Arab invasions, these two empires had declined in strength due to religious conflicts and revolts by the aristocracy. This made it easier for the Arabs to annex territories through wars and treaties. In three successful campaigns, 637-642, the Arabs brought Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Egypt under the control of Medina. Military strategy, religious fervor, and the weakness of the opposition contributed to the success of the Arabs. Further campaigns were launched by the third caliph, Uthman, to extend the control to Central Asia. Within a decade of the death of Muhammad, the Arab Islamic State controlled the vast territory between the Nile and the Oxus. These lands remain under Muslim rule to this day. In all the conquered provinces, the caliphs imposed a new administrative structure headed by governors, emirs, and tribal chieftains, ashraf. The central treasury, Bayt al-Mal, obtained its revenue from taxes paid by Muslims as well as its share of the booty from raids. The caliph's soldiers, mostly Bedouins, settled in camp cities at the edge of the desert, such as Kufa and Basra, to remain within reach of their natural habitat as well as the caliph's command. The ruling class and soldiers received shares of the booty and monthly payments, ada. The non-Muslim population retained their rights to property and religious practices on payment of taxes, kharaj and jizya. Jews and Christians were declared protected subjects of the state, dimas, and given a large measure of autonomy in the conduct of their communal affairs. Political expansion and unification did not come easily to the Arab tribesmen. With territorial expansion, the unity of the Ummah became threatened by conflicts over the distribution of resources and offices. The ruling class of the early Islamic State comprised almost entirely the Quraysh of Mecca. The third caliph, Uthman, 644-656, also a Quraysh, packed his administration with his own men to secure greater control. This further intensified the Meccan character of the state and the conflict with the other tribesmen. Opposition in Iraq and Egypt, combined with opposition in Medina, led to the assassination of Uthman. With Uthman's death, Ali became the fourth caliph. The rifts among the Muslims deepened after Ali, 656-61, fought two wars against those who represented the Meccan aristocracy. Ali's supporters and enemies later came to form the two main sects of Islam, Shias and Sunnis. Ali established himself at Kufa and defeated an army led by Muhammad's wife, Aisha, in the Battle of the Camel, 657. He was, however, not able to suppress the faction led by Muawiyah, a kinsman of Uthman and the governor of Syria. Ali's second battle, at Siffin, northern Mesopotamia, ended in a truce which split his followers into two groups. Some remained loyal to him, while others left the camp and came to be known as Kharijis. Soon after, Ali was assassinated by a Kharji in a mosque at Kufa. After his death, his followers paid allegiance to his son, Hussein, and his descendants. Muawiyah made himself the next caliph in 661, founding the Umayyad dynasty which lasted till 750. After the civil wars, it appeared as if Arab domination would disintegrate. There were also signs that the tribal conquerors were adopting the sophisticated culture of their subjects. It was under the Umayyads, a prosperous clan of the Quraysh tribe, that a second round of consolidation took place. The Umayyads and the centralization of polity, the conquest of large territories, destroyed the caliphate based in Medina and replaced it with an increasingly authoritarian polity. The Umayyads implemented a series of political measures which consolidated their leadership within the Ummah. The first Umayyad caliph, Muawiyah, moved his capital to Damascus and adopted the court ceremonies and administrative institutions of the Byzantine Empire. He also introduced hereditary succession and persuaded the leading Muslims to accept his son as his heir. These innovations were adopted by the caliphs who followed him, and allowed the Umayyads to retain power for 90 years and the Abbasids, for two centuries. The Umayyad state was now an imperial power, no longer based directly on Islam but on statecraft and the loyalty of Syrian troops. There were Christian advisors in the administration, as well as Zoroastrian scribes and bureaucrats. However, Islam continued to provide legitimacy to their rule. The Umayyads always appealed for unity and suppressed rebellions in the name of Islam. They also retained their Arab social identity. During the reign of Abd al-Malik, 685-705, and his successors, both the Arab and Islamic identities were strongly emphasized. Among the measures Abd al-Malik took were the adoption of Arabic as the language of administration and the introduction of an Islamic coinage. The gold dinar and silver dirham that had been circulating in the caliphate were copies of Byzantine and Iranian coins, denarius and dram, with symbols of crosses and fire altars and Greek and Pahlavi, the language of Iran, inscriptions. These symbols were removed and the coins now carried Arabic inscriptions. Abd al-Malik also made a highly visible contribution to the development of Arab Islamic Identity, by building the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem, the Abbasid Revolution for their success in centralizing the Muslim polity, the Umayyads paid a heavy price. A well-organized movement, called Dawah, brought down the Umayyads and replaced them with another family of Meccan origin, the Abbasids. In 750, the Abbasids portrayed the Umayyad regime as evil and promised a restoration of the original Islam of the Prophet. The revolution led not only to a change of dynasty but changes in the political structure and culture of Islam. The revolution led not only to a change of dynasty but changes in the political structure and culture of Islam. The Abbasid uprising broke out in the distant region of Khorasan, eastern Iran, a 20-day journey from Damascus on a fast horse. Khorasan had a mixed Arab-Iranian population which could be mobilized for various reasons. The Arab soldiers here were mostly from Iraq and resented the dominance of the Syrians. The civilian Arabs of Khorasan disliked the Umayyad regime for having made promises of tax concessions and privileges which were never fulfilled. As for the Iranian Muslims, Mawalai, they were exposed to the scorn of the race-conscious Arabs and were eager to join any campaign to oust the Umayyads. The Abbasids, descendants of Abbas, the Prophet's uncle, mustered the support of the various dissident groups and legitimized their bid for power by promising that a Messiah, Mahdi, from the family of the Prophet, al-Bayt, would liberate them from the oppressive Umayyad regime. Their army was led by an Iranian slave, Abu Muslim, who defeated the last Umayyad caliph, Marwan, in a battle at the river Zab. Under Abbasid rule, Arab influence declined, while the importance of Iranian culture increased. The Abbasids established their capital at Baghdad, near the ruins of the ancient Iranian metropolis, Ctesiphon. The army and bureaucracy were reorganized on a non-tribal basis to ensure greater participation by Iraq and Khorasan. The Abbasid rulers strengthened the religious status and functions of the caliphate and patronized Islamic institutions and scholars, but they were forced by the needs of government and empire to retain the centralized nature of the state. They maintained the magnificent imperial architecture and elaborate court ceremonials of the Umayyads. The regime, which took pride in having brought down the monarchy, found itself compelled to establish it again. Breakup of the caliphate and the rise of sultanates. The Abbasid state became weaker from the 9th century because Baghdad's control over the distant provinces declined, and because of conflict between pro-Arab and pro-Iranian factions in the army and bureaucracy. In 810, a civil war broke out between supporters of Amin and Mamun, sons of the Caliph Harun al-Rashid, which deepened the factionalism and created a new power block of Turkish slave officers, Mamluk. Shiism once again competed with Sunni orthodoxy for power. A number of minor dynasties arose, such as the Tahirids and Samanids in Khorasan and Transoxiana, Turin or lands beyond the Oxus, and the Tulunids in Egypt and Syria. Abbasid power was soon limited to central Iraq and western Iran. That too was lost in 945 when the Buyids, a Shiite clan from the Caspian region of Iran, Dalem, captured Baghdad. The Buyid rulers assumed various titles, including the ancient Iranian title Shahanshah, King of Kings, but not that of Caliph. They kept the Abbasid Caliph as the symbolic head of their Sunni subjects. The decision not to abolish the caliphate was a shrewd one, because another Shiite dynasty, the Fatimids, had ambitions to rule the Islamic world. The Fatimids belonged to the Ismaili subsect of Shiism and claimed to be descended from the Prophet's daughter, Fatima, and hence, the sole rightful rulers of Islam. From their base in North Africa, they conquered Egypt in 969 and established the Fatimid Caliphate. The old capital of Egypt, Fustat, was replaced by a new city, Kahira, Cairo. Founded on the day of the rise of the planet Mars, Mirak, also called Al-Kahir, the two rival dynasties patronized Shiite administrators, poets and scholars. Between 950 and 1200, Islamic society was held together not by a single political order or a single language of culture, Arabic, but by common economic and cultural patterns. Unity in the face of political divisions was maintained by the separation between state and society, the development of Persian as a language of Islamic high culture, and the maturity of the dialogue between intellectual traditions. Scholars, artists, and merchants moved freely within the central Islamic lands and assured the circulation of ideas and manners. Some of these also percolated down to the level of villages due to conversion. The Muslim population, less than 10% in the Umayyad and early Abbasid periods, increased enormously. The identity of Islam as a religion and a cultural system separate from other religions became much sharper, which made conversion possible and meaningful. A third ethnic group was added to the Arabs and Iranians, with the rise of the Turkish Sultanates in the 10th and 11th centuries. The Turks were nomadic tribes from the Central Asian steppes, grasslands, of Turkestan, northeast of the Aral Sea up to the borders of China, who gradually converted to Islam. They were skilled riders and warriors and entered the Abbasid, Samanid, and Buyid administrations as slaves and soldiers, rising to high positions on account of their loyalty and military abilities. The Ghaznavid Sultanate was established by Alptigin, 961, and consolidated by Mahmud of Ghazni, 998-1030. Like the Buyids, the Ghaznavids were a military dynasty with a professional army of Turks and Indians. One of the generals of Mahmud was an Indian named Tilak, but their center of power was in Khorasan and Afghanistan, and for them, the Abbasid caliphs were not rivals but a source of legitimacy. Mahmud was conscious of being the son of a slave and was especially eager to receive the title of Sultan from the caliph. The caliph was willing to support the Sunni Ghaznavid as a counterweight to Shiite power. The Saluk Turks entered Turin as soldiers in the armies of the Samanids and Karakhanids, non-Muslim Turks from further east. They later established themselves as a powerful group under the leadership of two brothers, Tufril and Chagri Beg. Taking advantage of the chaos following the death of Mahmud of Ghazni, the Saljuks conquered Khorasan in 1037 and made Nishapur their first capital. The Saljuks next turned their attention to western Persia and Iraq, ruled by the Buyids, and in 1055, restored Baghdad to Sunni rule. The Caliph, Al-Kaim, conferred on Tufril Beg the title of Sultan in a move that marked the separation of religious and political authority. The two Saluk brothers ruled together in accordance with the tribal notion of rule by the family as a whole. Tufril, death 1064, was succeeded by his nephew, Alparslan. During Alparslan's reign, the Saluk Empire expanded to Anatolia, modern Turkey. From the 11th to the 13th centuries, there was a series of conflicts between European Christians and the Arab states. This is discussed below. Then, at the start of the 13th century, the Muslim world found itself on the verge of a great disaster. This was the threat from the Mongols, the last but most decisive of all nomadic assaults on settled civilizations. The Crusades in medieval Islamic societies, Christians were regarded as the people of the book, al-Kitab, since they had their own scripture, the New Testament or Injil. Christians were granted safe conduct, amen, while venturing into Muslim states as merchants, pilgrims, ambassadors and travelers. These territories also included those which were once held by the Byzantine Empire, notably the Holy Land of Palestine. Jerusalem was conquered by the Arabs in 638, but it was ever present in the Christian imagination as the place of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. This was an important factor in the formation of the image of Muslims in Christian Europe. Hostility towards the Muslim world became more pronounced in the 11th century. Normans, Hungarians, and some Slavs had been converted to Christianity, and the Muslims alone remained as the main enemy. There was also a change in the social and economic organization of Western Europe in the 11th century, which contributed to the hostility between Christendom and the Islamic world. The clergy and the warrior class, the first two orders, were making efforts to ensure political stability as well as economic growth based on agriculture and trade. The possibilities of military confrontation between competing feudal principalities and a return to economic organization based on plunder were contained by the Peace of God movement. All military violence was forbidden inside certain areas, near places of worship, during certain periods considered sacred in the church's calendar, and against certain vulnerable social groups, such as churchmen and the common people. The Peace of God deflected the aggressive tendencies of feudal society away from the Christian world and towards the enemies of God. It built a climate in which fighting against the infidels, non-believers, became not only permissible but also commendable. The death in 1092 of Malik Shah, the Saluk Sultan of Baghdad, was followed by the disintegration of his empire. This offered the Byzantine Emperor, Alexius I, a chance to regain Asia Minor and northern Syria. For Pope Urban II, this was an opportunity to revive the spirit of Christianity. In 1095, the Pope joined the Byzantine Emperor in calling for a war in the name of God to liberate the Holy Land. Between 1095 and 1291, Western and European Christians planned and fought wars against Muslim cities on the coastal plains of the Eastern Mediterranean, Levant. These wars were later designated as Crusades. In the First Crusade, 1098-99, soldiers from France and Italy captured Antioch in Syria and claimed Jerusalem. Their victory was accompanied by the slaughter of Muslims and Jews in the city, chronicled by both Christians and Muslims. Muslim writers referred to the arrival of the Christians, called Ifrangi or Ferengi, as a Frankish invasion. The Franks quickly established four crusader states in the region of Syria-Palestine. Collectively, these territories were known as Outremer, the land overseas, and later crusades were directed at its defense and expansion. The Outremer survived well for some time, but when the Turks captured Edessa in 1144, an appeal was made by the Pope for a second crusade, 1145-49. A combined German and French army made an attempt to capture Damascus, but they were defeated and forced to return home. After this, there was a gradual erosion of the strength of Outremer. Crusader zeal gave way to living in luxury and to battles over territory among the Christian rulers. Salah al-Din, Saladin, created an Egypto-Syrian empire and gave the call for jihad or holy war against the Christians, and defeated them in 1187. He regained Jerusalem, nearly a century after the First Crusade. Records of the time indicate that Salah al-Din's treatment of the Christian population was humane, in marked contrast to the way in which Christians had earlier dealt with Muslims and Jews. Although he gave custody of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre to the Christians, a number of churches were turned into mosques, and Jerusalem once again became a Muslim city. The loss of the city prompted a third crusade in 1189, but the crusaders gained little except for some coastal towns in Palestine and free access to Jerusalem for Christian pilgrims. The Mamluks, the rulers of Egypt, finally drove the crusading Christians from all of Palestine in 1291. Europe gradually lost military interest in Islam and focused on its internal political and cultural development. The crusades left a lasting impact on two aspects of Christian-Muslim relations. One was the harsher attitude of the Muslim state towards its Christian subjects, which resulted from the bitter memories of the conflict as well as the needs for security in areas of mixed populations. The other was the greater influence of Italian mercantile communities, from Pisa, Genoa and Venice, in the trade between the East and the West even after the restoration of Muslim power. Economy, agriculture, urbanization and commerce. Agriculture was the principal occupation of the settled populations in the newly conquered territories. The Islamic State made no changes in this. Land was owned by big and small peasants and, in some cases, by the state. In Iraq and Iran, land existed in fairly large units cultivated by peasants. The estate owners collected taxes on behalf of the state during the Sasanian as well as Islamic periods. In areas that had moved from a pastoral to a settled agricultural system, land was the common property of the village. Finally, big estates that were abandoned by their owners after the Islamic conquests were acquired by the state and handed over mainly to the Muslim elites of the empire, particularly members of the caliph's family. The state had overall control of agricultural lands, deriving the bulk of its income from land revenue once the conquests were over. The lands conquered by the Arabs that remained in the hands of the owners were subject to a tax, kharaj, which varied from half to a fifth of the produce, according to the conditions of cultivation. On land held or cultivated by Muslims, the tax levied was one-tenth, USHR, of the produce. When non-Muslims started to convert to Islam to pay lower taxes, this reduced the income of the state. To address the shortfall, the caliphs first discouraged conversions and later adopted a uniform policy of taxation. From the 10th century onwards, the state authorized its officials to claim their salaries from agricultural revenues from territories, called ICTAs, revenue assignments. Agricultural prosperity went hand in hand with political stability. In many areas, especially in the Nile Valley, the state supported irrigation systems, the construction of dams and canals, and the digging of wells, often equipped with water wheels or noria, all of which were crucial for good harvests. Islamic law gave tax concessions to people who brought land under cultivation. Through peasant initiatives and state support, cultivable land expanded and productivity rose, even in the absence of major technological changes. Many new crops such as cotton, oranges, bananas, watermelons, spinach and brinjals, badingen, were grown and even exported to Europe. Islamic civilization flourished as the number of cities grew phenomenally. Many new cities were founded, mainly to settle Arab soldiers, junt, who formed the backbone of the local administration. Among this class of garrison cities, called MISR, the Arabic name for Egypt, were Kufa and Basra in Iraq, and Fustat and Cairo in Egypt. Within half a century of its establishment as the capital of the Abbasid Caliphate, 800, the population of Baghdad had reached around 1 million. Alongside these cities were older towns such as Damascus, Isfahan and Samarkand, which received a new lease of life. Their size and population surged, supported by an expansion in the production of food grains and raw materials such as cotton and sugar for urban manufacturers. A vast urban network developed, linking one town with another and forming a circuit. At the heart of the city were two building complexes radiating cultural and economic power, the Congregational Mosque, Masjid al-Jami, big enough to be seen from a distance, and the Central Marketplace, SUQ, with shops in a row, merchants' lodgings, fanduk, and the office of the money changer. The cities were homes to administrators, ayin or eyes of the state, and scholars and merchants, tujar, who lived close to the center. Ordinary citizens and soldiers had their living quarters in the outer circle, each fitted with its own mosque, church or synagogue, Jewish temple, subsidiary market and public bath, hammam, an important meeting place. At the outskirts were the houses of the urban poor, a market for green vegetables and fruits brought from the countryside, caravan stations and, unclean, shops, such as those dealing in tanning or butchering. Beyond the city walls were inns for people to rest when the city gates were shut and cemeteries. There were variations on this typology depending on the nature of the landscape, political traditions and historical events. Political unification and urban demand for foodstuffs and luxuries enlarged the circuit of exchange. Geography favored the Muslim Empire, which spread between the trading zones of the Indian Ocean and the Mediterranean. For five centuries, Arab and Iranian traders monopolized the maritime trade between China, India, and Europe. This trade passed through two major routes, namely, the Red Sea and the Persian Gulf. High-value goods suitable for long-distance trade, such as spices, textile, porcelain and gunpowder, were shipped from India and China to the Red Sea ports of Aden and Adab and the Gulf ports of Sirif and Basra. From here, the merchandise was carried overland in camel caravans to the warehouses, makazin, origin of the word magazine which has a similar collection of articles, of Baghdad, Damascus and Aleppo for local consumption or onward transmission. The caravans passing through Mecca got bigger whenever the Hajj coincided with the sailing seasons, mawasim, origin of the word monsoon, in the Indian Ocean. At the Mediterranean end of these trade routes, exports to Europe from the port of Alexandria were handled by Jewish merchants, some of whom traded directly with India, as can be seen from their letters preserved in the Jenazah collection. However, from the 10th century, the Red Sea route gained greater importance due to the rise of Cairo as a center of commerce and power and growing demand for Eastern goods from the trading cities of Italy. Towards the eastern end, caravans of Iranian merchants set out from Baghdad along the Silk Route to China, via the oasis cities of Bukhara and Samarkand, Transoxiana, to bring Central Asian and Chinese goods, including paper. Transoxiana also formed an important link in the commercial network which extended north to Russia and Scandinavia for the exchange of European goods, mainly fur, and Slavic captives, hence the word, slave. Islamic coins, used for the payment of these goods, were found in hoards discovered along the Volga River and in the Baltic region. Male and female Turkish slaves, gulam, too were purchased in these markets for the courts of the caliphs and sultans. The fiscal system, income and expenditure of the state, and market exchange increased the importance of money in the central Islamic lands. Coins of gold, silver and copper, fulus, were minted and circulated, often in bags sealed by money changers, to pay for goods and services. gold came from Africa, Sudan, and silver from Central Asia, Zarafshan Valley. Precious metals and coins also came from Europe, which used these to pay for its trade with the East. Rising demand for money forced people to release their accumulated reserves and idle wealth into circulation. Credit combined with currencies to oil the wheels of commerce. The greatest contribution of the Muslim world to medieval economic life was the development of superior methods of payment and business organization. Letters of credit, SAKK, origin of the word check, and bills of exchange, Suftaja, were used by merchants and bankers to transfer money from one place or individual to another. The widespread use of commercial papers freed merchants from the need to carry cash everywhere and also made their journeys safer. The Caliph too used the SAKK to pay salaries or reward poets and minstrels. Although it was customary for merchants to set up family businesses or employ slaves to run their affairs, formal businesses arrangements, muzarba, were also common in which sleeping partners entrusted capital to traveling merchants and shared profits and losses in an agreed proportion. Islam did not stop people from making money so long as certain prohibitions were respected. For instance, interest-bearing transactions, riba, were unlawful, although people circumvented usury in ingenious ways, hayl, such as borrowing money in one type of coin and paying in another while disguising the interest as a commission on currency exchange, the origin of the bill of exchange. Many tales from the Thousand and One Nights, Alf Layla Wa Layla, give us a picture of medieval Islamic society, featuring characters such as sailors, slaves, merchants and money changers. Learning and culture as the religious and social experiences of the Muslims deepened through contact with other people, the community was obliged to reflect on itself and confront issues pertaining to God and the world. What should be the ideal conduct of a Muslim in public and private? What is the object of creation and how does one know what God wants from his creatures? How can one understand the mysteries of the universe? Answers to such questions came from learned Muslims who acquired an organized knowledge of different kinds to strengthen the social identity of the community as well as to satisfy their intellectual curiosity. For religious scholars, ulama, knowledge, ilm, derived from the Quran and the model behavior of the Prophet, Sunnah, was the only way to know the will of God and provide guidance in this world. The ulama in medieval times devoted themselves to writing tafsir and documenting Muhammad's authentic hadith. Some went on to prepare a body of laws or sharia, the straight path, to govern the relationship of Muslims with God through rituals, ibadat, and with the rest of the humanity through social affairs, mu'amalat. In framing Islamic law, jurists also made use of reasoning, qiyas, since not everything was apparent in the Quran or hadith and life had become increasingly complex with urbanization. Differences in the interpretation of the sources and methods of jurisprudence led to the formation of four schools of law, mazhab, in the 8th and 9th centuries. These were the Maliki, Hanafi, Shafi and Hanbali schools, each named after a leading jurist, faqih, the last being the most conservative. The Sharia provided guidance on all possible legal issues within Sunni society, though it was more precise on questions of personal status, marriage, divorce and inheritance, than on commercial matters or penal and constitutional issues. Before it took its final form, the Sharia was adjusted to take into account the customary laws, URF, of the various regions as well as the laws of the state on political and social order, CSA Sharia. Customary laws, however, retained their strength in large parts of the countryside and continued to bypass the Sharia in matters such as the inheritance of land by daughters. In most regimes, the ruler or his officials dealt routinely with matters of state security and sent only selected cases to the qazi, judge. The qazi, appointed by the state in each city or locality, often acted as an arbitrator in disputes, rather than as a strict enforcer of the Sharia. A group of religious minded people in medieval Islam, known as Sufis, sought a deeper and more personal knowledge of God through asceticism, Rabbaniya, and mysticism. The more society gave itself up to material pursuits and pleasures, the more the Sufis sought to renounce the world, Zuhd, and rely on God alone. Tawakkul. In the 8th and 9th centuries, ascetic inclinations were elevated to the higher stage of mysticism, tasawwuf, by the ideas of pantheism and love. Pantheism is the idea of oneness of God and His creation, which implies that the human soul must be united with its Maker. Unity with God can be achieved through an intense love for God, ISHQ, which the woman Saint Rabia of Basra, death 891, preached in her poems. Bayezid Bistami, death 874, an Iranian Sufi, was the first to teach the importance of submerging the self, fana, in God. Sufis used musical concerts, sama, to induce ecstasy and stimulate emotions of love and passion. Sufism is open to all regardless of religious affiliation, status and gender. Dilnun Misri, death 861, whose grave can still be seen near the pyramids in Egypt, declared before the Abbasid Caliph, al-Mutawakkil, that he learned true Islam from an old woman, and true chivalry from a water carrier. By making religion more personal and less institutional, Sufism gained popularity and posed a challenge to Orthodox Islam. An alternative vision of God and the universe was developed by Islamic philosophers and scientists under the influence of Greek philosophy and science. During the 7th century, remnants of late Greek culture could still be found in the Byzantine and Sasanian empires, although they were slowly dying. In the schools of Alexandria, Syria and Mesopotamia, once part of Alexander's empire, Greek philosophy, mathematics and medicine were taught along with other subjects. The Umayyad and Abbasid caliphs commissioned the translation of Greek and Syriac books into Arabic by Christian scholars. Translation became a well-organized activity under al-Ma'mun, who supported the Library cum Institute of Science, Bayt al-Hikmah, in Baghdad where the scholars worked. The works of Aristotle, the elements of Euclid and Ptolemy's Almagest were brought to the attention of Arabic reading scholars. Indian works on astronomy, mathematics and medicine were also translated into Arabic during the same period. These works reached Europe and kindled interest in philosophy and science. The study of new subjects promoted critical inquiry and had a profound influence on Islamic intellectual life. Scholars with a theological bent of mind, such as the group known as Mu'tazila, used Greek logic and methods of reasoning, kalam, to defend Islamic beliefs. Philosophers, falasifa, posed wider questions and provided fresh answers. Ibn Sina, 980-1037, a doctor by profession and a philosopher, did not believe in the resurrection of the body on the Day of Judgment. This was met with strong opposition from theologians. His medical writings were widely read. The most influential was Al-Qanun fil Tibb, Canon of Medicine, a million-word manuscript that lists 760 drugs sold by the pharmacists of his day and includes notes on his own experiments conducted in hospitals, by Maristan. The canon points out the importance of dietetics, healing through dietary regulation, the influence of the climate and environment on health and the contagious nature of some diseases. The canon was used as a textbook in Europe, where the author was known as Avicenna. Just before his death, the scientist and poet Umar Khayyam was said to be reading the canon. His gold toothpick was found between two pages of the chapter on metaphysics. In medieval Islamic societies, fine language and a creative imagination were among the most appreciated qualities in a person. These qualities raised a person's communication to the level of adab, a term which implied literary and cultural refinement. Adab forms of expressions included poetry, nazm or orderly arrangement, and prose, nathr are scattered words, which were meant to be memorized and used when the occasion arose. The most popular poetic composition of pre-Islamic origin was the ode, Qasida, developed by poets of the Abbasid period to glorify the achievements of their patrons. Poets of Persian origin revitalized and reinvented Arabic poetry and challenged the cultural hegemony of the Arabs. Abu Nuwash, death 815, who was of Persian origin, broke new ground by composing classical poetry on new themes such as wine and male love with the intention of celebrating pleasures forbidden by Islam. After Abu Nuwash, the poets addressed the object of their passion in the masculine, even if the latter was a woman. Following the same tradition, the Sufis glorified the intoxication caused by the wine of mystical love. By the time the Arabs conquered Iran, Pahlavi, the language of the sacred books of ancient Iran, was in decay. A version of Pahlavi, known as New Persian, with a huge Arabic vocabulary, soon developed. The formation of sultanates in Khorasan and Transoxiana took New Persian to great cultural heights. The Samanid court poet Rudaki, death 940, was considered the father of New Persian poetry, which included new forms such as the short lyrical poem, Ghazal, and the quatrain, Rubai, plural Rubaiyat. The Rubai is a four-line stanza in which the first two lines set the stage, the third is finely poised, and the fourth delivers the point. In contrast to its form, the subject matter of the Rubai is unrestricted. It can be used to express the beauty of a beloved, praise a patron, or express the thoughts of the philosopher. The Rubai reached its zenith in the hands of Umar Khayyam, 1048-1131, also an astronomer and mathematician, who lived at various times in Bukhara, Samarkand and Isfahan. At the beginning of the 11th century, Ghazni became the center of Persian literary life. Poets were naturally attracted by the brilliance of the imperial court. Rulers, too, realized the importance of patronizing arts and learning for enhancing their prestige. Mahmud of Ghazni gathered around him a group of poets who composed anthologies, divans, and epic poetry, Mathnavi. The most outstanding was Ferdaza, death 1020, who took 30 years to complete the Shahnameh, Book of Kings, an epic of 50,000 couplets which has become a masterpiece of Islamic literature. The Shahnameh is a collection of traditions and legends, the most popular being that Rustam, which poetically depicts Iran from creation up until the Arab conquest. It was in keeping with the Ghaznavid tradition that Persian later became the language of administration and culture in India. The catalogue, Kitab al-Firist, of a Baghdad bookseller, Ibn Nadim, death 895, describes a large number of works written in prose for the moral education and amusement of readers. The oldest of these is a collection of animal fables called Kalila wa Dimna, the names of the two jackals who were the leading characters, which is the Arabic translation of a Pahlavi version of the Panchtantra. The most widespread and lasting literary works are the stories of hero adventurers such as Alexander, Iskandar, and Sindbad, or those of unhappy lovers such as Qais, known as Majnun or the Madman. These have developed over the centuries into oral and written traditions. The Thousand and One Nights is another collection of stories told by a single narrator, Shahrzad, to her husband night after night. The collection was originally in Indo-Persian and was translated into Arabic in Baghdad in the 8th century. More stories were later added in Cairo during the Mamluk period. These stories depict human beings of different types, the generous, the stupid, the gullible, the crafty, and were told to educate and entertain. In his Kitab al-Bikala, Book of Misers, Jahiz of Basra, death 868, collected amusing anecdotes about misers and also analyzed greed. From the 9th century onwards, the scope of adab was expanded to include biographies, manuals of ethics, akhlaq, mirrors for princes, books on statecraft, and, above all, history, tariq, and geography. The tradition of history writing was well established in literate Muslim societies. History books were read by scholars and students as well as by the broader literate public. For rulers and officials, history provided a good record of the glories and achievements of a dynasty as well as examples of the techniques of administration. In the two major historical works, Ansab al-Ashraf, Genealogies of the Obuls, of Baladara, death 892, and Tariq al-Rusul wal-Muluk, History of Prophets and Kings, of Tabari, the whole of human history was treated with the Islamic period as the focal point. The tradition of local history writing developed with the breakup of the caliphate. Books were written in Persian about dynasties, cities or regions to explore the unity and variety of the world of Islam. Geography and travel, Rila, constituted a special branch of adab. These combined knowledge from Greek, Iranian and Indian books with the observations of merchants and travelers. In mathematical geography, the inhabited world was divided into seven climes, singular iklim, parallel with the equator, corresponding to our three continents. The exact position of each city was determined astronomically. Muqaddasus, death 1000, descriptive geography, Asan al-Taqasim, the best divisions, is a comparative study of the countries and peoples of the world and a treasure trove of exotic curiosities. Geography and general history were combined in Maruj al-Dhahib, Golden Meadows, of Masudi, written in 943, to illustrate the wide variety of worldly cultures. Al-Biruni's famous Tahqiq Mal-il-Hind, History of India, was the greatest attempt by an 11th-century Muslim writer to look beyond the world of Islam and observe what was of value in another cultural tradition. By the 10th century, an Islamic world had emerged which was easily recognizable by travelers. Religious buildings were the greatest external symbols of this world. Mosques, shrines and tombs from Spain to Central Asia showed the same basic design, arches, domes, minarets and open courtyards, and expressed the spiritual and practical needs of Muslims. In the first Islamic century, the mosque acquired a distinct architectural form, roof supported by pillars, which transcended regional variations. The mosque had an open courtyard, san, where a fountain or pond was placed, leading to a vaulted hall which could accommodate long lines of worshippers and the prayer leader, imam. Two special features were located inside the hall, a niche, mihrab, in the wall indicating the direction of Mecca, qibla, and a pulpit, minbar, pronounced mimbar, from where sermons were delivered during noon prayers on Friday. Attached to the building was the minaret, a tower used to call the faithful to prayer at appointed times and to symbolize the presence of the new faith. Time was marked in cities and villages by the five daily prayers and weekly sermons. The same pattern of construction, of buildings built around a central courtyard, iwan, appeared not only in mosques and mausoleums but also in caravanserais, hospitals and palaces. The Umayyads built desert palaces in oases, such as Kirbat al-Mahar in Palestine and Qusay Ramra in Jordan, which served as luxurious residences and retreats for hunting and pleasure. The palaces, modeled on Roman and Sasanian architecture, were lavishly decorated with sculptures, mosaics and paintings of people. The Abbasids built a new imperial city in Samarra amidst gardens and running waters, which is mentioned in the stories and legends revolving round Harun al-Rashid. The great palaces of the Abbasid caliphs in Baghdad or the Fatimids in Cairo have disappeared, leaving only traces in literary texts. The rejection of representing living beings in the religious art of Islam promoted two art forms, calligraphy, kataita or the art of beautiful writing, and arabesque, geometric and vegetal designs. Small and big inscriptions, usually of religious quotations, were used to decorate architecture. Calligraphic art has been best preserved in manuscripts of the Quran dating from the 8th and 9th centuries. Literary works, such as the Kitab al-Aghani, Book of Songs, Kalila wa Dimna, and Muqamat of Hariri, were illustrated with miniature paintings. In addition, a wide variety of illumination techniques were introduced to enhance the beauty of a book. Plant and floral designs, based on the idea of the garden, were used in buildings and book illustrations. The history of the central Islamic lands brings together three important aspects of human civilization, religion, community and politics. We can see them as three circles which merge and appear as one in the 7th century. In the next five centuries the circles separate. Towards the end of our period, the influence of Islam over state and government was minimal, and politics involved many things which had no sanction in religion, kingship, civil wars, etc. The circles of religion and community overlapped. The Muslim community was united in its observance of the Sharia in rituals and personal matters. It was no more governing itself. Politics was a separate circle, but it was defining its religious identity. The only way the circles of religion and community could have separated was through the progressive secularization of Muslim society. Philosophers and Sufis advocated this, suggesting that civil society should be made autonomous, and rituals be replaced by private spirituality. 595 Muhammad marries Khadija, a wealthy Meccan trader who later supports Islam. 610-12 Muhammad has first revelation, first public preaching of Islam. 612. 621 first agreement at Aqaba with Medina converts. 622 migration from Mecca to Medina. Arab tribes of Medina, Ansar, shelter Meccan migrants, Muhajir. 632-661. Early Caliphate, conquests of Syria, Iraq, Iran and Egypt, civil wars, 661-750, Umayyad rule, Damascus becomes the capital, 750-945, Abbasid rule, Baghdad becomes the capital, 945, Buyids capture Baghdad, literary and cultural efflorescence. 1063-1092, rule of Nizam-ul-Mulk, the powerful Saluk wazir who established a string of madrasas called Nizamaya, killed by Hashishain, assassins. 1095-1291 Crusades, contacts between Muslims and Christians. 1111, death of Ghazali, influential Iranian scholar who opposed rationalism. 1258, Mongols capture Baghdad. Aramaic is a language related to Hebrew and Arabic. It has also been used in Ashokan inscriptions. Tribes are societies organized on the basis of blood relationships. The Arab tribes were made up of clans or combinations of large families. Unrelated clans also merged to make a tribe stronger. non-Arab individuals, Mawalai, became members through the patronage of prominent tribesmen. Even after converting to Islam, the Mawalai were never treated as equals by the Arab Muslims and had to pray in separate mosques. Medieval painting of Archangel Gabriel, Jibril, who brought messages to Muhammad. The first word he spoke was, recite, Iqra, from which has come the word Quran. In Islamic cosmology, angels are one of the three intelligent forms of life in the universe. The other two are humans and jinns. Islamic calendar. The Hijri era was established during the Caliphate of Umar, with the first year falling in 622 CE. A date in the Hijri calendar is followed by the letters A. The Hijri year is a lunar year of 354 days, 12 months, Muharram to Dhul Hijjah, of 29 or 30 days. Each day begins at sunset and each month with the sighting of the crescent moon. The Hijri year is about 11 days shorter than the solar year. Therefore, none of the Islamic religious festivals, including the Ramadan fast, Eid and Hajj, corresponds in any way to seasons. There is no easy way to match the dates in the Hijri calendar with the dates in the Gregorian calendar, established by Pope Gregory XIII in 1582 CE. One can calculate the rough equivalence between the Islamic H and Gregorian Christian C years with the following formulae: H times 32/33 plus 622 equals C. C 622 times 33/32 equals H. The Dome of the Rock, built over a rocky mound by Abd al-Malik, is the earliest major work of Islamic architecture. Created as a monument to the Muslim presence in the city of Jerusalem, it acquired a mystical association connected with the Eid journey of the Prophet to heaven, Miraj. Abd al-Malik's coinage reform. The three coin specimens show the transition from Byzantine to Arab Islamic coinage. On the second coin, the bearded and long-haired caliph is dressed in traditional Arab robes and is holding a sword. It is the first extant portrait of a Muslim. It is also unique because later there developed an antipathy towards the representation of living beings in art and craft. Abd al-Malik's reform of coinage was linked with his reorganization of state finances. It proved so successful that for hundreds of years, coins were struck according to the pattern and weight of the third specimen. The Great Mosque of al-Mutawakkil in Samarra, the second Abbasid capital, built in 850. The minor is 50 meters high and is made of brick. Inspired by Mesopotamian architectural traditions, this was the largest mosque in the world for centuries. Franks in Syria. The treatment of the subjugated Muslim population differed among the various Frankish lords. The earliest of the Crusaders, who settled down in Syria and Palestine, were generally more tolerant of the Muslim population than those who came later. In his memoirs, Usama ibn Munshi, a 12th-century Syrian Muslim, has something interesting to say about his new neighbors. Among the Franks there are some who have settled down in this country and associated with Muslims. These are better than the newcomers, but they are exceptions to the rule, and no inference can be drawn from them. Here is an example. Once I sent a man to Antioch on business. At that time, Chief Theodore Sofianos, an Eastern Christian, was there, and he and I were friends. He was then all-powerful in Antioch. One day he said to my man, one of my Frankish friends has invited me, come with me and see how they live. My man told me, so I went with him, and we came to the house of one of the old knights, those who had come with the first Frankish expedition. He had already retired from state and military service, and had a property in Antioch from which he lived. He produced a fine table, with food both tasty and cleanly served. He saw that I was reluctant to eat, and said, eat to your heart's content, for I do not eat Frankish food. I have Egyptian women cooks and eat nothing but what they prepare, nor does swine flesh ever enter my house. So I ate, but with some caution, and we took our leave. Later I was walking through the market, when suddenly a Frankish woman caught hold of me and began jabbering in their language, and I could not understand what she was saying. A crowd of Franks collected against me, and I was sure that my end had come. Then, suddenly, that same knight appeared and saw me, and came up to that woman, and asked her, what do you want of this Muslim? She replied, he killed my brother Hirsa. This Hirsa was a knight of Afamia who had been killed by someone from the army of Hama. Then the knight shouted at her and said, this man is a Burjasa, bourgeois, that is, a merchant. He does not fight or go to war. And he shouted at the crowd and they dispersed. Then he took my hand and went away. So the effect of that meal that I had was to save me from death. Kitab al-Adbar. Paper, Janaza records and history in the central Islamic lands. Written works were widely circulated after the introduction of paper. paper, made from linen, came from China, where the manufacturing process was a closely guarded secret. In 751, the Muslim governor of Samarkand took 20,000 Chinese invaders as prisoners, some of whom were good at making paper. For the next 100 years, Samarkand paper remained an important export item. Since Islam prohibited monopolies, paper began to be manufactured in the rest of the Islamic world. By the middle of the 10th century, it had more or less replaced papyrus, the writing material made from the inner stem of a plant that grew freely in the Nile Valley. Demand for paper increased, and Abd al-Latif, a doctor from Baghdad and a resident of Egypt between 1193 and 1207, reported how Egyptian peasants robbed graves to obtain mummy wrappings made of linen to sell to paper factories. Paper also facilitated the writing of commercial and personal documents of all kinds. In 1896, a huge collection of medieval Jewish documents was discovered in a sealed room, Genizah, pronounced Geniza, of the Ben Ezra Synagogue in Fustat. The documents had been preserved thanks to the Jewish practice of not destroying any piece of writing that contained the name of God. The Geniza was found to contain over a quarter of a million manuscripts and fragments dating back as far as the mid 8th century. Most of the material dated from the 10th to the 13th centuries, that is, from the Fatimid, Ayyubid and early Mamluk periods. These included personal letters between merchants, family and friends, contracts, promises of dowry, sale documents, laundry lists, and other trivia. Most of the documents were written in Judeo-Arabic, a version of Arabic written in Hebrew characters that was commonly used by Jewish communities throughout the medieval Mediterranean. The Geniza documents provide rich insights into personal and economic experiences as also into Mediterranean and Islamic culture. The documents also suggest that the business skills and commercial techniques of merchants of the medieval Islamic world were more advanced than those of their European counterparts. Goitein wrote a multi-volume history of the Mediterranean from Geniza records, and Amit of Ghosh was inspired by a Geniza letter to tell the story of an Indian slave in his book, In an Antique Land, Courtyard of Mustansiriya Madrasa of Baghdad, founded in 1233. The madrasa was a college of learning for students who had finished their schooling in Maktab. Madrasas were attached to mosques, but big madrasas had a mosque attached to them. The Quran, and if all the trees on earth were pens and the ocean were ink with seven oceans behind it to add to its supply, yet would not the words of Allah be exhausted in the writing? Quran, chapter 31, verse 27. The Quran is a book in Arabic divided into 114 chapters, surahs, and arranged in descending order of length, the shortest being the last. The only exception to this is the first surah, which is a short prayer, al-fatiha or opening. According to Muslim tradition, the Quran is a collection of messages, revelations, which God sent to the Prophet Muhammad between 610 and 632, first in Mecca and then in Medina. The task of compiling these revelations was completed sometime in 650. The oldest complete Quran we have today dates from the 9th century. There are many fragments which are older, the earliest being the verses engraved on the Dome of the Rock and on coins in the 7th century. The use of the Quran as a source material for the history of early Islam has posed some problems. The first is that it is a scripture, a text vested with religious authority. Theologians generally believed that as the speech of God, Kalam Allah, it has to be understood literally, but rationalists among them gave wider interpretations to the Quran. In 833, the Abbasid Caliph al-Ma'mun imposed the view, in a trial of faith or minna, that the Quran is God's creation rather than his speech. The second problem is that the Quran very often speaks in metaphors and, unlike the Old Testament, Torah, it does not narrate events but only refers to them. Medieval Islamic scholars thus had to make sense of many verses with the help of hadith. Many hadith were written to help the reading of the Quran. The ideal student Abd al-Latif, a 12th century legal and medical scholar of Baghdad, talks to his ideal student, I commend you not to learn your sciences from books unaided, even though you may trust your ability to understand. Resort to teachers for each science you seek to acquire, and should your teacher be limited in his knowledge, take all that he can offer, until you find another more accomplished than he. You must venerate and respect him. When you read a book, make every effort to learn it by heart and master its meaning. Imagine the book to have disappeared and that you can dispense with it, unaffected by its loss. One should read histories, study biographies and the experiences of nations. By doing this, it will be as though, in his short life space, he lived contemporaneously with peoples of the past, was on intimate terms with them, and knew the good and bad among them. You should model your conduct on that of the early Muslims. Therefore, read the biography of the Prophet and follow in his footsteps. You should frequently distrust your nature, rather than have a good opinion of it, submitting your thoughts to men of learning and their works, proceeding with caution and avoiding haste. He who has not endured the stress of study will not taste the joy of knowledge. When you have finished your study and reflection, occupy your tongue with the mention of God's name, and sing his praises. Do not complain if the world turns its back on you. Know that learning leaves a trail and a scent proclaiming its possessor, a ray of light and brightness shining on him, pointing him out. Ahmad ibn al-Qasim ibn Abi Usabiya, Uyun al-Anba, the Islamic decorative genius found full expression in the art of metal objects that are among the best preserved specimens. This mosque lamp from 14th century Syria has the light verse inscribed on it. God is the light, N-U-R, of the heavens and the earth. His light is like a niche, Mishkat, with a lamp, Mizbah. The lamp is in a glass which looks as if it were a glittering star kindled from a blessed olive, Zaytun, tree that is neither eastern nor western, whose oil would always shine even if no fire, N-A-R, touched it. Quran, chapter 24, verse 35. Theme 5. Nomadic empires. The term nomadic empires can appear contradictory. Nomads are arguably quintessential wanderers, organized in family assemblies with a relatively undifferentiated economic life and rudimentary systems of political organization. The term empire, on the other hand, carries with it the sense of a material location, a stability derived from complex social and economic structures and the governance of an extensive territorial dominion through an elaborate administrative system. But the juxtapositions on which these definitions are framed may be too narrowly and ahistorically conceived. They certainly collapse when we study some imperial formations constructed by nomadic groups. In Theme 4 we studied state formations in the central Islamic lands whose origins lay in the Bedouin nomadic traditions of the Arabian Peninsula. This chapter studies a different group of nomads, the Mongols of Central Asia, who established a transcontinental empire under the leadership of Genghis Khan, straddling Europe and Asia during the 13th and 14th centuries. Relative to the agrarian-based imperial formations in China, the neighboring nomads of Mongolia may have inhabited a humbler, less complex, social and economic world. But the Central Asian nomadic societies were not insulated, islands that were impervious to historical change. These societies interacted, had an impact on and learned from the larger world of which they were very much a part. This chapter studies the manner in which the Mongols under Genghis Khan adapted their traditional social and political customs to create a fearsome military machine and a sophisticated method of governance. The challenge of ruling a dominion spanning a melange of people, economies, and confessional systems meant that the Mongols could not simply impose their steppe traditions over their recently annexed territories. They innovated and compromised, creating a nomadic empire that had a huge impact on the history of Eurasia even as it changed the character and composition of their own society forever. The steppe dwellers themselves usually produced no literature, so our knowledge of nomadic societies comes mainly from chronicles, travelogues and documents produced by city-based literateurs. These authors often produced extremely ignorant and biased reports of nomadic life. The imperial success of the Mongols, however, attracted many literati. Some of them produced travelogues of their experiences, others stayed to serve Mongol masters. These individuals came from a variety of backgrounds: Buddhist, Confucian, Christian, Turkish and Muslim. Although not always familiar with Mongol customs, many of them produced sympathetic accounts, even eulogies, that challenged and complicated the otherwise hostile, city-based tirade against the steppe marauders. The history of the Mongols, therefore, provides interesting details to question the manner in which sedentary societies usually characterized nomads as primitive barbarians. Perhaps the most valuable research on the Mongols was done by Russian scholars starting in the 18th and 19th centuries as the Tsarist regime consolidated its control over Central Asia. This work was produced within a colonial milieu and was largely survey notes produced by travelers, soldiers, merchants and antiquarian scholars. In the early 20th century, after the extension of the Soviet republics in the region, a new Marxist historiography argued that the prevalent mode of production determined the nature of social relations. It placed Genghis Khan and the emerging Mongol Empire within a scale of human evolution that was witnessing a transition from a tribal to a feudal mode of production, from a relatively classless society to one where there were wide differences between the lord, the owners of land, and the peasant. Despite following such a deterministic interpretation of history, excellent research on Mongol languages, their society and culture was carried out by scholars such as Boris Yakovlevich Vladimirtsov. Others such as Vasily Vladimirovich Bartold did not quite toe the official line. At a time when the Stalinist regime was extremely wary of regional nationalism, Bartold's sympathetic and positive assessment of the career and achievements of the Mongols under Genghis Khan and his successors got him into trouble with the censors. It severely curtailed the circulation of the work of the scholar, and it was only in the 1960s, during and after the more liberal Khrushchev era, that his writings were published in 9 volumes. The transcontinental span of the Mongol Empire also meant that the sources available to scholars are written in a vast number of languages. Perhaps the most crucial are the sources in Chinese, Mongolian, Persian and Arabic, but vital materials are also available in Italian, Latin, French and Russian. Often the same text was produced in 2 languages with differing contents. For example, the Mongolian and Chinese versions of the earliest narrative on Genghis Khan, titled Mongolun Naiwi Tobian, The Secret History of the Mongols, are quite different, and the Italian and Latin versions of Marco Polo's travels to the Mongol court do not match. Since the Mongols produced little literature on their own and were instead written about by literati from foreign cultural milieus, historians have to often double as philologists to pick out the meanings of phrases for their closest approximation to Mongol usage. The work of scholars like Igor Dorachewilts on the secret history of the Mongols and Gerhard Dorfer on Mongol and Turkic terminologies that infiltrated into the Persian language brings out the difficulties involved in studying the history of the Central Asian nomads. As we will notice through the remainder of this chapter, despite their incredible achievements, there is much about Genghis Khan and the Mongol world empire still awaiting the diligent scholar's scrutiny. Introduction. In the early decades of the 13th century, the great empires of the Euro-Asian continent realized the dangers posed to them by the arrival of a new political power in the steppes of Central Asia. Genghis Khan, death 1227, had united the Mongol people. Genghis Khan's political vision, however, went far beyond the creation of a confederacy of Mongol tribes in the steppes of Central Asia. He had a mandate from God to rule the world. Even though his own lifetime was spent consolidating his hold over the Mongol tribes, leading and directing campaigns into adjoining areas in North China, Transoxiana, Afghanistan, eastern Iran and the Russian steppes, his descendants traveled further afield to fulfill Genghis Khan's vision and create the largest empire the world had ever seen. It was in the spirit of Genghis Khan's ideals that his grandson Mongke, 1251-1260, warned the French ruler, Louis IX, 1226-1270, "In heaven there is only one eternal sky, on earth there is only one Lord." Genghis Khan, the son of heaven, when by the power of the eternal heaven the whole world from the rising of the sun to its setting shall be at one in joy and peace, then it will be made clear what we are going to do. If when you have understood the decree of the eternal heaven, you are unwilling to pay attention and believe it, saying, "Our country is far away, our mountains are mighty, our sea is vast," and in this confidence you bring an army against us, we know what we can do. He who made easy what was difficult and near what was far off, the eternal heaven knows. These were not empty threats, and the 1236-1241 campaigns of Batu, another grandson of Genghis Khan, devastated Russian lands up to Moscow, seized Poland and Hungary and camped outside Vienna. In the 13th century it did seem that the eternal sky was on the side of the Mongols, and many parts of China, the Middle East and Europe saw in Genghis Khan's conquests of the inhabited world the wrath of God, the beginning of the day of judgment. How did the Mongols create an empire that dwarfed the achievements of the other world conqueror, Alexander? In a pre-industrial age of poor technological communications, what skills were deployed by the Mongols to administer and control such a vast dominion? for someone so self-confidently aware of his moral, divinely dispensed right to rule, how did Genghis Khan relate to the diverse social and religious groups that comprised his dominion? In the making of his imperium, what happened to this plurality? We need to start our discussion, however, with a humbler set of questions to better comprehend the social and political background of the Mongols and Genghis Khan. Who were the Mongols? Where did they live? Who did they interact with, and how do we know about their society and politics? Social and political background. The Mongols were a diverse body of people, linked by similarities of language to the Tatars, Khitan and Manchus to the east, and the Turkic tribes to the west. Some of the Mongols were pastoralists while others were hunter-gatherers. The pastoralists tended horses, sheep and, to a lesser extent, cattle, goats and camels. They nomadized in the steppes of Central Asia in a tract of land in the area of the modern state of Mongolia. This was, and still is, a majestic landscape with wide horizons, rolling plains, ringed by the snow-capped Altai Mountains to the west, the arid Gobi Desert in the south and drained by the Anan and Selenga rivers and myriad springs from the melting snows of the hills in the north and the west. Lush, luxuriant grasses for pasture and considerable small game were available in a good season. The hunter-gatherers resided to the north of the pastoralists in the Siberian forests. They were a humbler body of people than the pastoralists, making a living from trade in furs of animals trapped in the summer months. There were extremes of temperature in the entire region, harsh, long winters followed by brief, dry summers. Agriculture was possible in the pastoral regions during short parts of the year, but the Mongols, unlike some of the Turks further west, did not take to farming. Neither the pastoral nor the hunting-gathering economies could sustain dense population settlements, and as a result the region possessed no cities. The Mongols lived in tents, gurs, and traveled with their herds from their winter to summer pasture lands. Ethnic and language ties united the Mongol people, but the scarce resources meant that their society was divided into patrilineal lineages. The richer families were larger, possessed more animals and pasture lands. They therefore had many followers and were more influential in local politics. Periodic natural calamities, either unusually harsh, cold winters when game and stored provisions ran out, or drought which parched the grasslands, would force families to forage further afield, leading to conflict over pasture lands and predatory raids in search of livestock. Groups of families would occasionally ally for offensive and defensive purposes around richer and more powerful lineages, but, barring the few exceptions, these confederacies were usually small and short-lived. The size of Genghis Khan's confederation of Mongol and Turkish tribes was perhaps matched in size only by that which had been stitched together in the 5th century by Attila, death 453. Unlike Attila, however, Genghis Khan's political system was far more durable and survived its founder. It was stable enough to counter larger armies with superior equipment in China, Iran, and Eastern Europe. And, as they established control over these regions, the Mongols administered complex agrarian economies and urban settlements, sedentary societies, that were quite distant from their own social experience and habitat. Although the social and political organizations of the nomadic and agrarian economies were very different, the two societies were hardly foreign to each other. In fact, the scant resources of the steppe lands drove Mongols and other Central Asian nomads to trade and barter with their sedentary neighbors in China. This was mutually beneficial to both parties. Agricultural produce and iron utensils from China were exchanged for horses, furs, and game trapped in the steppe. Commerce was not without its tensions, especially as the two groups unhesitatingly applied military pressure to enhance profit. When the Mongol lineages allied, they could force their Chinese neighbors to offer better terms, and trade ties were sometimes discarded in favor of outright plunder. This relationship would alter when the Mongols were in disarray. The Chinese would then confidently assert their influence in the steppe. These frontier wars were more debilitating to settled societies. They dislocated agriculture and plundered cities. Nomads, on the other hand, could retreat away from the zone of conflict with marginal losses. Throughout its history, China suffered extensively from nomad intrusion and different regimes. Even as early as the 8th century BCE, built fortifications to protect their subjects. Starting from the 3rd century BCE, these fortifications started to be integrated into a common defensive outwork known today as the Great Wall of China, a dramatic visual testament to the disturbance and fear perpetrated by nomadic raids on the agrarian societies of North China. career of Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan was born sometime around 1162 near the Anan River in the north of present-day Mongolia, named Temujin. He was the son of Yesugai, the chieftain of the Kiat, a group of families related to the Borjigit clan. His father was murdered at an early age and his mother, Olenik, raised Temujin, his brothers and stepbrothers in great hardship. The following decade was full of reversals. Temujin was captured and enslaved, and soon after his marriage, his wife, Bort, was kidnapped, and he had to fight to recover her. During these years of hardship, he also managed to make important friends. The young Bogurchu was his first ally and remained a trusted friend. Jamukha, his blood brother, Anda, was another. Temujin also restored old alliances with the ruler of the Karayats, Tufril, Angkan, his father's old blood brother. Through the 1180s and 1190s, Temujin remained an ally of Angkan and used the alliance to defeat powerful adversaries like Jamukha, his old friend who had become a hostile foe. It was after defeating him that Temujin felt confident enough to move against other tribes, the powerful Tatars, his father's assassins, the Karayats, and Angkan himself in 1203. The final defeat of the Naiman people and the powerful Jamukha in 1206 left Temujin as the dominant personality in the politics of the steppe lands, a position that was recognized at an assembly of Mongol chieftains, Kurilte, where he was proclaimed the Great Khan of the Mongols, Qaan, with the title Genghis Khan, the Oceanic Khan, or Universal Ruler. Just before the Kurilte of 1206, Genghis Khan had reorganized the Mongol people into a more effective, disciplined military force that facilitated the success of his future campaigns. The first of his concerns was to conquer China, divided at this time into three realms: the Shisha people of Tibetan origin in the northwestern provinces, the Jurchen, whose Qin dynasty ruled North China from Peking, the Song dynasty, who controlled South China. By 1209, the Shisha were defeated, the Great Wall of China was breached in 1213, and Peking sacked in 1215. Long drawn-out battles against the Qin continued until 1234, but Genghis Khan was satisfied enough with the progress of his campaigns to return to his Mongolian homeland in 1216 and leave the military affairs of the region to his subordinates. After the defeat in 1218 of the Qara-Khita, who controlled the Tian Shan Mountains northwest of China, Mongol dominions reached the Amu Darya and the states of Transoxiana and Khwarezm. Sultan Muhammad, the ruler of Khwarezm, felt the fury of Genghis Khan's rage when he executed Mongol envoys. In the campaigns between 1219 and 1221, the great cities, Otrar, Bukhara, Samarkand, Balkh, Gurganj, Merv, Nishapur and Herat, surrendered to the Mongol forces. Towns that resisted were devastated. At Nishapur, where a Mongol prince was killed during the siege operation, Genghis Khan commanded that the town should be laid waste in such a manner that the site could be plowed upon, and that in the exaction of vengeance for the death of the prince, not even cats and dogs should be left alive. Mongol forces in pursuit of Sultan Muhammad pushed into Azerbaijan, defeated Russian forces at the Crimea and encircled the Caspian Sea. Another wing followed the Sultan's son, Jalaluddin, into Afghanistan and the Sindh province. At the banks of